All right, we're carrying on. 1 Corinthians. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 2, that's where Paul turns his attention to issues related to the worship assembly in Corinth, a subject that'll occupy him through chapter 14. And as I said last week, chapter 11, verses 2 through 16 addresses the need to maintain cultural sexual distinctions in attire. Now, when I was so rudely, and I mean rudely, interrupted by the bell, I was in the middle of making some preliminary remarks about chapter 11, verses 2 through 16, intended to explain my overall view and perspective on the section, and I think that'll save us some time when we get to the actual text. Now, let me quickly recap what I said last week. I'll try to make that fast, and then I'll finish my preliminary thoughts, and then we will turn to the text itself. Now, the impropriety that is involved in chapter 11, verses 2 to 16 is not women praying and prophesying, but they're doing so uncovered. And as I mentioned, the clear implication is that Christian women were authorized to pray and prophesy publicly in some setting. Now, public speaking in that day and age, it was largely a male activity. And the fact women in Christ were authorized to engage in traditionally male speech, that fed the idea, it seems. It fed the idea of some in Corinth that sex distinctions were no longer relevant in the new age of Christ. Do you remember we saw that in chapter 7, this overrealized eschatology that we are already now, like in the age, the consummation. And you saw that there, and I think the same thing is playing out here. Since sex distinctions were no longer relevant, the argument was, well, then neither were items of apparel that marked those sex differences. In Christ, the women, they were free to pray and prophesy as men were, which some claimed meant without the covering that distinguished men and women. So I think that's what's going on here. As for where Christian women were authorized to pray and prophesy, I'm convinced, I gave the reasons last week why I and virtually all commentators are convinced that at least some of this female speech addressed in 11, 2 through 16 took place in the worship assembly. Now, when I said that, that statement no doubt caused some of you to think, or at least I hope it did, well, wait a minute. 1 Corinthians 14, 33 through 36 forbids any kind of female speaking in the assembly. Paul there commands women to be silent, so neither female praying or prophesying, neither one, neither female praying nor prophesying could have taken place in the assembly. Now, I said I would explain when we get to chapter 14 why I do not believe 1 Corinthians 14, 33 through 36 is a blanket prohibition of female speech in the assembly. Rather, in the context, and it seems to me quite clearly in the context, it's a prohibition against female participation in what I call the prophetic process in the assembly. Meaning that in that setting, women were not to prophesy or to challenge, weigh the prophecies delivered by others. And the rationale for that prohibition is the same rationale that Paul gives in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. Now, women in the assembly, when the community of believers gathers together, they are to express their divinely ordered submissiveness to men, their non-leading status, by refraining from authoritative speech. And we recognize that, right? When somebody gets up here and says, God is good, and the congregation says back all the time, we don't say, only men. I only want to hear men say all the time. You see, so we recognize that in practice, that what is being dealt with here is authoritative speech. In other words, in the assembly, women are not to direct the men. They're not to set them straight by delivering God's authoritative message to them. Women are forbidden from doing that, either directly by prophesying or teaching, or indirectly by challenging the prophecies and teachings of others. Now, this understanding, in fact, it comports with what we see in the history of the early church. Everett Ferguson, many of you know Ferguson. He is an internationally respected church historian. He was the editor of the Encyclopedia of Early Christianity. And if I turn this on first, you'll get to see what he says. Ferguson says, from the standpoint of history, the evidence of Christian writings of the 2nd to 4th centuries is in continuity with the New Testament. Women were not appointed as elders, nor did they take public speaking roles in the assembly as prophets, teachers, or leaders in the assembly. Where women did take these roles in heretical or schismatic groups, the practice was a basis for objection to these groups. So what I'm suggesting to you is it comports with what we see in history. Now, right when we ended, I explained that I know this difference in roles, it rankles some people, but it is not because women are less intelligent, less moral, less capable, any of that. That is simply not what is behind it. And you can't jump to that idea. It is because God in His sovereignty chose to put the leadership responsibility on men, and that choice is to be acknowledged or honored in the assembly. Now, the insistence that we see sometimes, the insistence that God not restrict specific roles to specific groups, the claim that He must allow everyone access to all roles based on capability, that claim was met with a resounding no in the situation of Korah's rebellion in Numbers chapter 16. And that's right where we ended. Now, if I'm correct in thinking that at least some of the female speech that's addressed in 1 Corinthians 11, 2 to 16, took place in the worship assembly, and if I'm also correct in thinking that 1 Corinthians 14, 33b through 36 precludes female prophesying in the assembly, well, then the female speech that took place in the worship assembly was prayer. Now, in other words, in my understanding is that women in Christ were authorized to pray publicly both in and outside of the worship assembly, but were authorized to prophesy publicly only outside of the assembly. Prayer being a non-instructive expression of devotion to God is not a way of directing men. And therefore, in my understanding, it's not inconsistent with the submission a woman is required to manifest in the assembly. I think, for example, Acts 1:14, Acts 4:23 and 24, I think these are probably examples of women praying publicly in the assembly. Okay, that is not airtight. There are a couple of unlikely ways I think you can get around that conclusion, but I think probably those are examples of that. And I am aware that some believe 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8, where Paul says he wants the men in every place to pray. That some people think that means that women are not to pray in the assembly. But I don't think that follows. Paul doesn't say he wants the men to pray. That's not what he says. He says he wants the men to pray, what? Without anger and argument. He assumes they will be praying. And he urges them to do so with a proper attitude so that their prayers will not be hindered. It's like if on the brink of a recess, a teacher said, I want the boys to play without fighting. Nobody would think that the teacher was thereby precluding girls from playing. They would think that the boys had a problem with fighting that the teacher did not want carried over into recess. That's how I look at that. Now, I think the issue that Paul is addressing, it arose with regard to women in the assembly who were seeking to pray. My judgment, they were authorized to pray in and out of the assembly, to prophesy only out of the assembly. And the issue comes up, Paul, in my judgment, the issue arose with regard to women in the assembly who were seeking to pray without the covering. And if you look at 1 Corinthians 11:13, this is a text that I think doesn't get its due, because here Paul sets specifically, as I read it, the issue. He says, judge among yourselves. He's laying out the issue. What he's talking about, judge among yourselves, is it proper that a woman pray to God uncovered? He doesn't talk about prophesying. Is it proper that a woman pray to God uncovered? You see, so though the immediate issue, as I read it, is covering during prayer in the assembly. I take it from that. I take it from what he says in 14 about prophesying not being something women do in the assembly. So in light of that, see, that's what I think. So the immediate issue, though, is prayer during the assembly. You say, well, why is he mentioning women prophesying? All right, I think the issue is women seeking to pray uncovered in the assembly, but he mentions women prophesying because the argument being made to justify women praying in the assembly uncovered also would justify women prophesying outside of the assembly uncovered. See, if the right to engage in traditionally male activity, that activity of public speech, if that right justifies doing so as men did, meaning without that culture's distinctive mark of femaleness, then it would justify doing so whether the public speech was in or out of the assembly, right? So by logic, a ruling on the assembly situation, if the rationale, the argument is, because we now are authorized in Christ to participate in traditionally male speech, therefore, we are authorized to do so as men do, that is, without the culture's distinctive mark of femaleness. Now, if that's the issue that's being raised regarding prayer in the assembly, for Paul to rule on that, given the rationale, the argument that's being made in support of it, he would then be also ruling on the situation outside the assembly. To say that that's okay to do that there, he would then also be saying that it's okay to prophesy outside without the covering. That's why I think he brings the two up. I think the issue is praying uncovered in the assembly. Now, if, as I've suggested, the rationale for jettisoning the covering, if that was that women wore, is because, look, we're authorized to speak publicly as men who did so without a covering, then you say, well, then why weren't women, if that's the rationale, why weren't women also pushing to prophesy in the assembly as men did? Right? I mean, that's a good question. In other words, why focus only on the head covering? Why do that, you see, rather than also challenge the restriction against prophesying in the assembly? Would not prophesying as men also include doing so in the assembly? And my answer to that is, I can imagine challenges to ongoing practice being introduced incrementally, proceeding one step at a time. I mean, that wouldn't shock me at all. Perhaps the advocates of the view that distinctions between men and women were passé in the age of Christ, perhaps they wanted to downplay the impact of that view on the assembly by first seeking only to discard the covering as a test case of the principle. Or perhaps, less calculatingly, an individual had raised the specific question, perhaps it just arose historically. that an individual had raised the specific question of the covering in the assembly, in praying there, and that put that particular issue front and center. Now, the fact that Paul, in my judgment, in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, 33 through 36, says that women may not prophesy in the assembly, that indicates to me that Paul is aware that the issue of women prophesying is circulating around these claims. In other words, it's tied up with them. But I think what's happening is this has come up because women are praying in the assembly. They're praying in the assembly and out. They're prophesying only out. Someone in the assembly raises this issue of can we do so, pray uncovered in the assembly. Now, before anybody gets too upset with me, if I'm correct in thinking that women prayed publicly in the assemblies of the early church, it doesn't necessarily follow that women are permitted to, quote, lead prayers in a church gathering. Whether that is acceptable, that boils down to, in my judgment, whether the female participation in that role would violate the biblical principle of male leadership. And I'm inclined to think it would, because that role has a sense of leadership that's not present in some other context. The person who leads a prayer in our assemblies, that person's not just praying personally. Rather, that person has been appointed to speak to God on behalf of the assembly. And I don't think that's the kind of public praying that women engaged in. But in a context like open praying, you see, where all are invited to pray personally without any appointment or designation to speak for the assembly, which I suspect was more common in the house churches of the early church, that concern wouldn't seem to me to apply. And of course, even in a congregation that already utilized open praying, where there was no designation or appointment to speak on behalf of the congregation, even in a congregation that did that in its assemblies, the potential impact on congregational unity would have to factor into any shift that was made from an open praying situation where only men prayed to an open praying situation that included both men and women praying. You'd have to think through those things in terms of the impact on the unity of the congregation. Now, wherever the women were praying and prophesying, the problem here is that some women were pressing to do so without the customary female covering. Now, I'm going to turn to the text. All right, here we go. Text. You thought we'd never get here, but here we go. He says, "Now I praise you because you have remembered me in all things and hold fast the traditions just as I delivered them to you. And I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of woman is the man, and the head of Christ is God. Every man who prays or prophesies having a covering upon the head disgraces his head. And every woman who prays or prophesies uncovered as to the head disgraces her head. For she is one and the same thing as the woman who has been shaved. For if a woman does not cover herself, let her also have her hair cut short. And if it is shameful for a woman to have her hair cut short or to be shaved, let her cover herself." All right, now after praising the leaders for following the practice that he had passed on to them, Paul proceeds to give them reasons for the practice, something they could surely use in defending their position against the current challenge. So they had been following what Paul had saying, but you get this sense, you see, that there are issues being raised and people pushing certain things. And I'm sure elders don't know anything about that. But you see that this is something. So Paul praises them for holding, but he's now going to give them some rationale or some reasons for the practice that will surely be helpful to them. And he begins by denying the notion that sex is completely irrelevant in the church. I use sex instead of gender. I know the word now, gender. Everybody talks about gender, but for me growing up, that was a grammatical term. Sex, I'm talking male, female. Okay? So Paul here, he begins by denying the notion that sex is completely irrelevant in the church, and he does so by asserting that the relationship between men and women in the church is not identical or reciprocal with regard to leadership. Rather, men are given the leadership responsibility in the church. Man is the head of woman, but woman is not the head of man. And Christ is the head of man in some distinctive way, presumably because of man's leadership responsibility. And you say, what's all this talk about heads? Why is Paul speaking this way? Paul is speaking this way. He's using, phrasing everything in terms of a head, because head plays into the issue of head covering. So that's why he's phrasing it this way. Chiampa and Rossner, in their commentary, they say, if some Corinthians were arguing that Christ, as head of the church, was head over men and women in the same way, since in the new creation there's no longer any male and female, Paul seems to be affirming that the creation pattern is still significant and cannot be shrugged off. While there is tension between creation and new creation, especially fallen creation and new creation, creation is the context in which Christians live out their lives, and it cannot be passed off as irrelevant. Now, I am aware that some claim that the term head here doesn't connote leadership authority, that it means source or these kinds of things. I'm aware of that. I'm also aware that some claim that man and woman should be translated instead as husband and wife. But I am in broad scholarly company in concluding that those claims do not stand up. Now, regarding the meaning of head, you can simply consult any of the standard Greek lexicons, the standard theological dictionaries. You can just take a look there. And regarding the translation man and woman rather than husband and wife, Anthony Thistleton says a few commentators defend husband, but the overwhelming majority of writers convincingly argue that the issue concerns gender relations as a whole, not simply those within the more restricted family circle. And that is why the vast majority of English translations render the words man and woman. I know the ESV doesn't, but the vast majority of them do, and on that issue I think the ESV took a misstep. Now, as I said, the fact that man is given the leadership role does not mean men are superior to women in character, in intellect, or capabilities. And all I would say is anybody who thinks otherwise must not know any women. Right? I mean, you have to just be out of your mind. You know, and you look at some of the women in church history, by the way. And you take a look at some of them and how they lived and the strength with which they lived and died for Jesus. And you'll be going, okay, I get it. So that idea, that's not at all what is being said. Men and women simply have different roles and functions. The man is to lead, and the woman is to be a helping partner in the joint enterprise of glorifying God. Now, that being head of need not include intrinsic superiority or greater worth is evident from the statement that the head of Christ is God. Right? Just think about that. A basic confession of the Christian faith is that the Son is one with the Father in nature. He is in no way less worthy or inferior in being. And yet he says God is the head of Christ. So do you think that in saying that, he's saying that the Father is intrinsically superior to the Son? Or do you think he's saying they have different roles? It's the latter. You see, they have different roles. The difference between the Father and the Son is one of role or function. The Son freely embraces the leadership of the Father. I think James Hurley, the New Testament scholar, I think he well captured the spirit of male leadership in his book titled Man and Woman in Biblical Perspective. Now, his comments deal specifically with husbands and wives, but I think they're applicable to male leadership in general. Here's what Hurley says. The manner in which such decisions are handled is crucial. He's talking about family decisions with a husband and wife. The husband may not be high-handed and stubborn, knowing that she will finally have to give way. That is not the model of Christ's headship. Neither may the wife be grudging and resentful. That is not the manner of our response to Christ. In the last analysis, when the two can devote no more time to individual and joint seeking of the grace of God to permit them to come to one mind or to be willing to yield to the other, an exchange along the following lines is in order. Husband, not because I am inherently wiser or more righteous, nor because I am right, although I do believe I am or I wouldn't stand firm, but because it is finally my responsibility before God, we will take the course which I believe is right. If I am being sinfully stubborn, may God forgive me and give me the grace to yield to you. Wife, not because I believe you are wiser in this matter, I don't, or more righteous, nor because I accept that you're right, because I don't, or I wouldn't oppose you, but because I am a servant of God who has called me to honor your headship, I willingly yield to your decision. If I am wrong, may God show me. If you are wrong, may he give you grace to acknowledge it and to change. I think that captures the spirit of male leadership. You see, I've used this many times for that reason. The idea, whether it's in the church or whether it's in family, that a husband is a boss who browbeats his wife is insane. Okay? It is simply not biblical. How are you going to do that to somebody you would die for? Okay? But that's another question. I won't get off on that. Now, given the continuing relevance of sex for those who are in Christ, it is inappropriate to reject cultural sex distinctions in attire, to engage in a kind of cross-dressing when publicly speaking to or on behalf of God, when praying or prophesying. Now, the cultural expectation regarding female head coverings in Greco-Roman society in the mid-first century, that is debated, and sometimes quite warmly. But such a covering for women appearing in public, it certainly was the traditional practice. Ben Witherington, in his book, Women in the Earliest Churches, Witherington, after talking about various pieces of evidence, he says, how do we assess this evidence? It seems sufficient to show that the wearing of a head covering by an adult woman in public, especially in a ritual context, was a traditional practice known to Jews, Greeks, and Romans. Now, the practice, it continued during and after the time of Paul, but as a cultural norm, it seems it was being chipped at or rebelled against by certain classes of women in certain contexts. Now, that doesn't mean, however, that it had been displaced as a cultural norm, especially in a public assembly where men and women mix together. And you just think of an example. If Hollywood, I know this would never happen. You see, it would never happen. But if Hollywood rejected or rebelled against some kind of cultural norm, the fact Hollywood was rejecting or rebelling against that norm would not mean that rebelling against that norm wasn't viewed as shameful in the larger culture. Just because somebody was chipping at the norm wouldn't mean the norm had already been displaced. Now, I recognize that in our age of celebrity worship and mass communication, it really doesn't take Hollywood very long to displace the norm. But that wasn't really true in the ancient world. David Garland, well-known commentator, New Testament scholar, has a commentary on 1 Corinthians I've mentioned a number of times. He notes that it was widely regarded as a disgrace for a Hebrew woman to go out uncovered. And then Garland says, Paul is not imposing Palestinian customs on the Corinthians, however. The Corinthian culture also looked askance at women going out in public without a head covering. Ciampa and Rossner in their commentary say, perhaps more central to Paul's thinking is the need to maintain a strict distinction between the sexes, one that was traditionally associated with some type of antithetical manifestation. Woman look one way, guy look the other. You see, and he says, for example, men were associated with public life, women with the privacy of the household, men were to be in the open, and women covered, etc. In Paul's context, men and women were expected to have contrasting head styles, especially in public. Women were more commonly expected to have their heads covered while in public. And William Baker, in his 2009 commentary, says, covering the head with a hood or veil outside the home was standard practice for women in Roman, Greek, and Jewish culture. So I want you to see, this is obviously a big issue. This is pivotal for how I understand what's going on, and I want you to know there's debate about precisely, but it's really hard to get down with that degree of granularity, get down that specifically to see what was the cultural norm and expectation, particularly in a ritual context. It's not that easy, because you'll see portraits or a painting or something, you say, well, how does that factor into what was actually happening on the street in Corinth? And I think from what Paul says, it's pretty clear that this is what's happening. Now, just as it would be disgraceful for any man to pray or prophesy with a female covering on his head, just as that would be disgraceful, so it would be disgraceful for a woman to do so without it. It would be disgraceful for a man to pray with a female covering on his head. Just as that's the case, it would be disgraceful for a woman to do so without it. And it's disgraceful because it's an act of rebellion against the created order. And as such, it brings shame on both the rebel and the rebel's leader or the rebel's head. Now, the sexual nature of the shame, like I say, this to me is about created order. It's about the sexes. You have this attire that is female. It's inappropriate on a man, and it's inappropriate for a woman to discard it. Now, that the issue here, that the shame that is discussed, it is sexual in nature. The sexual nature of the shame is evident in verses 5, the second part of 5. And in verse 6, he says, for the woman who prays or prophesies without the cover disgraces her head. Why? Why does she disgrace her head? For she is one and the same thing as the woman who has been shaved. That's why she disgraces her head by going uncovered. Verse 6 emphasizes the closeness of the parallel between being shaved and going uncovered. Now, the shame of a woman who had been shaved, the shame was appearing as a man, appearing contrary to her sex. There are a couple of passages in the writings of Lucian, a second century Greek satirist, that clearly show that short hair on a woman at this time, in this place, was considered mannish. In fact, James B. DeYoung, who's a New Testament scholar, he says the shame seems related to a woman's becoming like a man in her style of hair, becoming mannish. This suggests that the women at Corinth were blurring distinctions between men and women, especially sexual distinctions. That's what I think is going on. I think the women are being encouraged to cast off the cultural distinctiveness of the female covering, to be mannish in that way. And that is rebellion against the created order. The reason is that sexual distinctions still pertain in the church. We are not yet at this age, as some of them are claiming, where these distinctions no longer amount to anything. You see, we're not doing that. We're not at that place. Now, Her shame was not from the short hair itself. You have to understand that. Do you see, this is not a thing about short hair is objectively, universally, something God condemns. Short hair on a woman. It's culturally defined. It's culturally defined. Her shame was not from the short hair itself, but from the fact short hair was culturally defined as the hair of a man. See, in the same way, the shame of going uncovered, that shame was not from the attire itself. It's not some objective rule. It's not from the attire itself. It's from the fact that the lack of a cover was culturally defined as the attire of a man. Just as short hair was culturally defined as the hair of a man, going without the cover was culturally defined as being the attire of a man. And so you are rebelling against the created distinctiveness of the sexes, and you can't do that. You see, you can't do that. Even though we are in the church time, even though we're in the age of Christ, you cannot do that because sexual distinctions still pertain. And so that's what I think Paul is talking about when he's, you know, this is what I think is at issue. Now he says in 11:7-12, "For a man ought not to cover his head, being the image and glory of God, the woman..." I wanted to say something before I do this, by the way. This is one of the things, you know, sometimes people come up and they say, "Oh, well, you believe the Bible, right?" "Yeah, I believe the Bible." You don't do what the Bible says. You don't have your women covering their head. And this is one of the things that just drives me crazy. I have said many times that if you're going to understand the Bible, you can't read it as though God delivered it just to you yesterday. You have to recognize, if you're going to handle the Bible correctly, that God speaks to us today through what the Spirit said to the Christians in Corinth. And if you're going to hear what God says to us today correctly, you first have to hear what He said to the church in Corinth or any other place, right? So that's the thing. So once you get down and you see, well, what is Paul saying to the Christians in Corinth? And if, as I'm telling you, that there is a cultural trigger that is defined as a rebellion against the created order in terms of sex, I would then say, no, I do apply this. I live by this. Because in our culture, a woman not having a covering is not perceived or defined as a rebellion against sex. So if you understand what's happening, don't tell me I'm not living by it. I am living by it, but I'm living by it rightly. I'm not living by it as somebody who just parachutes into the Bible, grabs isolated texts, and says, "God said this to me today." You see, studying the Bible's more difficult than that. You have to get down and dig down and understand what's being said, and then you're in a position to speak about these things. All right, that's a footnote, no charge. All right, back here. "For a man ought not to cover his head, being the image and glory of God. The woman, on the other hand, is the glory of man." That means, by the way, in addition to God. He doesn't say that, but I'm convinced that's implied. He's certainly not saying woman is not the glory of God. God made woman, okay? But man is the, see, it says the image and glory of God only. Woman, on the other hand, is the glory of man, paren, in addition to God, paren. All right? "For man is not from woman, but woman from man." Okay, we're back to Genesis. "For neither was the man created on account of the woman, but the woman on account of the man. For this reason, the woman ought to have authority on her head on account of the angels. Nevertheless, neither is woman apart from man, nor man apart from woman in the Lord. For just as the woman is from the man, so also the man is by the woman, and all things are from God." Now, verses 7 to 10, they provide a further reason why a man should not wear the cover, but a woman should. You see, Paul's been talking about this. He's been saying that this is something that is culturally defined as an act of rebellion against sexual distinction. So it's inappropriate. When you're speaking publicly to or on behalf of God, when you're praying or prophesying, you can't do that. You see, you can't be in that act of rebellion against the created order and be doing that. Well, 7 to 10, he provides a further reason why the man shouldn't wear the cover, but the woman should. It's this kind of sex inappropriate dressing. It not only violates God's created order, it also ignores the fact that woman's existence glorifies man, as I said, in addition to God. It ignores the fact that woman's existence glorifies man, whereas man's existence glorifies only God. You see, this difference in the object of glorification, that difference has implications for who is a suitable candidate for wearing female clothing. Woman's existence glorifies man because man what? He gave birth to woman. Right? He gave birth to woman. And because woman was made to help him, to be a non-leading partner. Eve is created from Adam. Adam is made just from the dirt. But Eve, woman, owes her existence to man. He is her progenitor. God made woman from man, so her existence redounds to the glory of man because she was made out of him. That's not true of man. He wasn't made out of woman. His existence glorifies only God. All right, so woman's existence glorifies man in addition to God. That's my parentheses that I'm certain is there. Glorifies man in addition to God, man's existence glorifies God exclusively. Doesn't also glorify woman because man didn't come from woman. Now that's important for who is the proper and fitting object of wearing female covering. Now why is that? It's because female covering, both culturally and biblically, women have a non-leading role. Okay, they have a non-leading role, so man is the glory of God exclusively. So it's unfitting for him to have that cover. Whereas it is fitting for the woman to have that cover. Because he says, for man is not from woman, but woman from man. For neither was the man created on account of the woman, but the woman on account of the man. Right back to Genesis. For the reason the woman ought to have authority on her head, for this reason the woman ought to have authority on her head, then he says that kind of enigmatic thing, on account of the angels. You see, and I mentioned to you last week, I think the most likely way to understand that, you had at Qumran, for example, you had this idea that angels, which is a Jewish sect, you know, the Essenes. Okay, second bell. All right, we'll carry on next week. That wasn't as bad as the interruption last week. Thanks.